When it comes to building a reliable race car, one of the common areas we see problems is with the wiring harness. Now, building a reliable wiring harness requires some specialist equipment, some specialist techniques, and of course some specialist knowledge. And we're here with Cody from Cody Philips Racing, who's built this immaculate Supra behind us. And we're going to find out what exactly goes into the wiring harness that he's constructed for this Supra. Before we actually get stuck into the harness on the Supra though, let's go back a little bit and I want to really dive into how you got involved in building these harnesses in the first place. It's an area where there is unfortunately very little knowledge, and those that have that knowledge do tend to keep it pretty closely guarded. How did you get started?
I think really it came down to as I started tuning more and more cars and my capability advanced into more of the Motec systems and more advanced standalones that weren't plug and play, and more projects that weren't street cars or whatnot. We had to figure out a way to wire that stuff up. And it just started with, I would go to tune cars on a dyno and a boost control solenoid would be wired wrong. Fuel pressure sensor would be wired wrong. So getting the crimpers, figuring out how all that went. And then of course, really just loving the data behind it all. You know, the more data I could gather, the more I'd crunch it. And so adding sensors into things always seemed more and more intriguing. So it really just happened very naturally. It wasn't anything that I ever dreamed of doing as a job. It just, as I tuned more cars, they all needed to be wired, and I wanted to step up the game and you know, do a nice loom on it. So
now, I've seen this myself with my own career. We get a car on the dyno, and 9 times out of 10, when we have problems, it does come down to the wiring harness. So I share your pain, and I know how that goes. But there's one thing, getting competent in building a quality wiring harness that we'd see on a street car or maybe a club level race car. But then we've got the harness that you've constructed for your own Supra, and of course the harnesses you're now constructing for your customers. And these are next level. We're talking here professional motorsport wiring harnesses, and these are very different from your garden variety club level and street harnesses. So how did you go to that level? How did you learn the techniques such as concentric twisting, how to use Autosport connectors, etc., how to choose the correct crimp tools? Where did that knowledge come from?
I think it just comes down to you need certain things on the car, and packaging all of that is difficult. So creating a loom that was smaller, creating a loom that could fit around tight places, and something that, you know, I work in a lot of off-road applications, and it's got to be robust, it's got to be strong. And so strain relieving came into play, you know, getting rid of solder came into play, because originally you kind of start down that path and you don't know any better. And so you really just have to study what's out there. There's, you know, there wasn't a class like you guys do now. There wasn't anything. And so really you just kind of study the guys out there and see if you can pick up tidbits. And through the years, I picked up a lot of relationships with those guys. And so, you know, we share some information and whatnot. But it's just a natural progression as you start down that path, I believe. So.
Now, you've just mentioned a couple of pretty hot topics here. I want to just jump back in and unpack them, and this is surely going to become somewhat controversial. I want to start with the age-old debate of solder versus crimping. And we always have a lot of people who are big fans of solder for connecting wires or terminating wires. And of course, in professional motorsport wiring harness construction, solder is very, very rarely used. Can you tell us what your take is on the solder versus crimping debate?
Really, for years I soldered stuff because, like I said, I didn't know any better. And what I found on my own was my own failures. And those are tough lessons to learn. But, you know, I'd sent looms to clients and they take it off a jump and the car stops working, and they show me what's down there at a 12 volt splice at the ECU with a piece of solder on it, and the solder's holding nice and tight, but you know, one of the main wires is just busted off, and it just can't take the vibration. It doesn't do well when you heat the solder. The insulator doesn't work well up against it. It gets brittle. And so really learning to crimp everything after that. Many of my clients still think that these looms are soldered, you know, because everything's covered. Everything's covered in boots and back shelled and glued, and it's built that way. But really, there's not a drop of solder in the entire loom. Everything is crimped and stripped, and you have to get those tools to do it properly. You have to invest into it. the materials alone are thousands of dollars to do the looms, and as well as the time. But you know, that there is that debate, and really, I figured it out on my own, whether I had to read anything on the internet, because I had my own failures. And
yeah, learning from your own failures is obviously the best way. And I think I just want to dive into this a little bit, because one of the constant arguments we hear when we bring up the solder versus crimping debate is, but I've had a solder joint on my own car and it's lasted fine, so therefore soldering's okay. And yes, that may well be the case, but the fact still remains that at the end of your solder joint, you're going to have a brittle area that can work hard in fatigue, and it is prone to failure. Doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to fail, doesn't mean it's going to fail today, tomorrow, or maybe even in 5 years' time, but if it is subjected to the right amount of vibration for enough time, it can fail. So that's why we try and stay away from solder. The crimping, when done correctly, is a more reliable option. Now, the next technique I want to talk about that you just mentioned before was the way the harness is actually constructed. So talking here about concentric twisting. And again, this is an area we actually get quite a lot of debate from. Often this comes from those who are involved in the aeronautic industry, maybe producing harnesses or repairing harnesses for aircraft. And generally, these harnesses aren't constructed in that technique. There's always horses for courses, but can you give us your opinion on why concentric twisting is a superior technique for a motorsport application?
For me, it really comes down to packaging. So these looms need to acquire a lot of data. They have a lot of sensors, and we need things to be light, and we can't have a 3-inch cable coming through our firewall. It's just not going to look nice and function correctly. So it really comes down to packaging, and inside that, you know, raychem that you're going to shrink down, I want to use every single void of that. And so really the only way to do that properly and make it look nice is to do concentric twisting and center our shielded cables, you know, put heavier gauge stuff in the center, and then make the outside nice and pliable, do proper strain relief. Those are other techniques, but really it just comes down to getting the packaging right and having flexibility and getting a lot out of a small size of the loom.
I think it's also important with a concentrically twisted harness in an automotive application. The real idea there is that no single wire is supplied any more stress than any other. So there's no stress placed into the wires, or minimal stress placed into the wires. It gives you a tight bundle, a minimal cross-sectional area, so it makes it easy to run a wiring harness through a tight engine bay. But just as importantly as well, it retains that flexibility, which is important in a car where you're running your wiring harness from a firewall through to the engine, which may move on the engine mounts, whereas in an aeronautical application, it's much less of a consideration. And then, of course, you've got that DR25 raychem sheathing that you're heat shrinking down. Again, in our wiring harnesses in an automotive application, they are in the engine bay, they're exposed to heat, but just as importantly, they're exposed to moisture and a lot of nasty chemicals. So that DR25 provides some abrasion resistance as well as resistance to heat and those chemicals. Is that a fairest sort of way of putting that?
Yeah, and I think there's a distinct piece there that just because you have a raychem on your harness or loom doesn't make it mil-spec or high quality or all that. Because you can buy the raychem, it's a quality product. A lot of people see it and they go, oh, I want a raychem mil-spec harness. It really comes down to using proper boots, boot sizing, gluing the boots with proper epoxy, strain relief at an Autosport, and really the layup of the loom as well. So a lot of people just think, oh yeah, I got a raychem harness and it's this or that. And
It's what's actually underneath really that counts.
Really, the cover is, yeah, great. It's raychem. It'll protect. It'll heat and abrasion. But it's really inside what counts. And you really don't get to showcase it because it's all covered up.
Yeah, that is the sad thing. The amount of effort and the techniques that go into these harnesses, really at the end of the day, you've got very little to show for it other than that exterior sheathing. All right, so with the background of the way, how you got involved there and some of those techniques that we've just covered with motorsport wiring harness construction, I want to delve into the actual harness that you've put into your Supra here. So can you start by maybe giving us some of the thought process you go through in the design stage? What's important to understand before you even start stripping and cutting wires for the first time?
So any time that I talk to a customer, they want to wire their own project and I'll sell them a PDM or whatever, I tell them, you have to do your documentation first. So planning is super critical. And I think I learned this the hard way. You're on a tight deadline. The wiring guys always get left to the end. No time left in the schedule. And you really just need to stop and plan for what you ultimately want. I think the looms that I sell to my customers, you know, they're fairly pricey, but I sell them with really anything that they would want long term down the road, so they can grow into the piece. So I think the planning is critical. Like, I'll put turbo speed in there, EMAP, you know, and some of that stuff really sounds typical. But a guy who's just putting the car together and wants to go race, oh, I'm not going to use that stuff down the road. And then, hey, we want to know our turbo speed. Well, it's there. You just buy the sensor and plug it in. So
building in some redundancy at the start. And I think it's also worth pointing out that these harnesses really, once they are completed, you've got almost no chance of really adding or modifying the wiring in them.
Yeah, I mean, we always typically run spares. So for any expansion, it's hard to really fill up an M150 on a Supra. But when we start doing the transmission, the automatic transmission control and the wheel speeds and that sort of thing, we generally will fill it up. We do so much data on the car through CAN and programming that we don't have any, like, you know, low side output triggers and that sort of thing. So we can reserve all of the pins in the Autosport to really just give us the data from the sensors and really have a lot of growth for the overall package. So that's kind of where I aim is, look, I'll sell you this one. You won't have to buy another one. If you want to add a spare sensor, a new Wazoo sensor that comes out, there's a couple of wires left in there for you to do that. So.
All right, so where the wiring harness comes through to the engine bay, you're using bulkhead connectors there that are quick disconnect Autosport connectors. Can you tell us how those work and why they're an advantage?
I really like to use only Autosports. So a lot of people use Mil-Spec connectors. To me, it comes down to packaging again. I can get a high pin count in a small density. And when I'm using just the engine loom, you know, generally we just use like a size 20 Autosport, a 2035 is a common one for me, and it uses all size 22 pins in it, and I can get all the engine vitals going through that. So the packaging is critical. They also do not use a back shell that screws on. So a Mil-Spec connector takes the back shell that screws on, your boot goes onto that, and over time, you know, a lot of loom builders have had to actually Loctite that to keep it tight, and you go through vibration and heat cycles and that sort of thing, and that back shell can tend to loosen. So preference for me is really just using Autosports only. So you see my car and most of my clients' cars, it's really just Autosports in it.
And one of the nice features with those Autosport connectors as well is it does make it easier and quicker when you're servicing the vehicle. For example, if you had to do an engine swap at the track, then instead of having to remove the wiring harness from each of the individual sensors and locations on the engine, the harness can stay with the engine, quick half-turn disconnect at the firewall and everything can come out. You've actually gone a little bit further than that. Can you tell us how you've made it easier to remove the inlet manifold?
So on the inlet manifold, I have all 12 injectors and the TPS and the MAP sensor all going through two Autosports. I mounted those underneath the intake manifold. So anytime we want to service the car, we don't mess around with unplugging injectors. All of our injectors are booted. Everything's sealed so that if they ever get yanked on or anything, the wires aren't going to come out. But simple. All you do is break the fuel rails, break the two Autosports, and remove the hardware, and the intake manifold can come off with everything still in place. Even the loom just comes right with it. So
I think these are some of those nice little things that can be really easy to overlook. But when we are dealing with race cars, they do require servicing. And things like the inlet manifold are coming off frequently.
Yep.
So thinking about that in advance really makes a big difference. Can you tell us about the ignition system on this particular car and how you've considered the wiring on that and why that's important?
This uses the M&W Prodrax 6. So it's the dual box, the older style.
So this is a CDI ignition system?
CDI, yeah. And we use stock coils with the CDI. It's proven on the 2J to work very well. I do a lot of IGN 1A coils as well, so there's not any big, you know, debate on that. I do both systems. I chose the Pro Drags on my car. I ran it through a separate loom just to keep noise out of the engine harness, but mainly as well as serviceability. If somebody damages a coil or has a fire or something, we can just replace that one loom. And, you know, we're dealing with shielded cable, so it's larger, and really keeping the packaging down is critical there. So I've got a AS14 that I run that through and just run for the coils.
Now, another nice feature that I noticed when we were looking over this car as well is you've got a little button sitting there in the engine bay that you can crank the engine over with. So can you just tell us why you've included that and why that's helpful?
Well, I think it's, you know, like you said, a car like this gets serviced and you need to look at it, do compression tests, do leak downs. I put it in there for that, but I also, when I start the car, I just lean in and touch the keypad to turn on the CDI, and then just walk up to the front, run the throttle if I need to, run the starter. I can see everything going on. I don't have to climb in the roll cage every single time to warm the car up. So it's really a convenience thing. Is you know, bump the engine over, check cams or any of that. So.
In terms of the power supply for all of the components, you're running a Motec PDM or power distribution module. Can you talk to us a little bit about how that helps you when it comes to the wiring? I know there's a lot of debate about the expense of, or the added expense of a PDM, but there's also a saving there in terms of the time it takes to wire up conventional fuses and relays. How's that all work out in your mind?
Well, I think the way that I explain it to clients is if you want to run a PDM30, that's going to give you 30 circuits. So we need 30 relays, and we need 30 fuses, and we need 30 switches. So, I mean, when you mount all that and the labor and the wiring and the complexity of that, it really becomes a no-brainer, because you may pay for more money for the PDM up front. You get a ton more capability, but you're going to pay more in labor to wire up all those mechanical switches and relays and fuses, especially time-wise on my end. It's going to take quadruple, five times the amount of time to do that than it is just to wire up the PDM straight away. So
yeah, I think it's really important when you're looking at these products and comparing prices. It's not just the price of the component you need to consider, but it's the actual final price of that component once all said and done and it's installed in the car. Not to mention, of course, the added functionality, diagnostic advantages that power distribution modules can give. Now, the other thing that I've noticed in this car that's quite unique is that you're running two Motec CAN-based keypads. You've got one up the front of the car, and then you've got one in the trunk area. Can you tell us, first of all, what is the CAN-based keypad and why is that important, and then why are you using two of them?
Well, the keypad is nice because it gives all its data over the CAN bus. It's only wired in with four wires, and as I talked before, if you wanted 15 switches, like with our front keypad, you would need to wire 15 wires. So it's nice to just do the four and get the data across the bus to get your functionality. Really, the keypad in the rear came down to just serviceability between rounds. Our air-to-water ice tank is in the back. We need to put ice in it. We need to cycle the pump. Sometimes we need to purge the nitrous. My mechanic needs to go through and check vitals on the C-127. So back there, you can cycle the dash. You can run the fans. You can run the keypad. And it's not a bit of climbing in and out of this roll cage between rounds. So just like the button in front of the engine bay, it's really just an easy service type of thing.
So a little bit of added money for the additional keypad and a little bit of additional wiring, but at the end of the day, all of these things add up to making the car just that much easier to work on. Look, the harness work in this car is an absolute work of art. We're really looking forward to seeing how the car performs this weekend. And if someone out there wants to get hold of you, maybe learn a little bit more about your work, where can they go to?
On Instagram, we're at Cody Philips Racing, same as Facebook. Our website's www.codyphillipsracing.com. We still take phone calls, we still take emails, but yeah, social, any of that stuff, the web, all great ways.
Great. Thanks for your time there, Cody, and good luck for the rest of the weekend.
All right. Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.